All right. Good morning. So I'll be talking about some very basic questions about non-equilibrium quantum systems. So as you will see, there has been quite a bit of progress, and on the experimental side, it's been thanks to the developments in the synthetic quantum systems. On the theory side, I think what has been very valuable is bringing in concepts and some techniques from quantum information, and so that will hopefully become clear as we go along. And so, and first today, so I will continue sort of where Norm left off. So I'll tell a little bit about normalization and ways to avoid it. So at a very basic level, describing interacting quantum systems is difficult because Hilbert space grows very quickly with the number of particles, right? So if you have, for example, n spins 1/2, right? If you want to describe where the rainbow state precisely, you would need a principle 2 to the power n parameters. So it's really a three-way function. And you know, you can even wonder, so how we can understand anything at all about quantum interacting systems, right? And if you think about it, in almost every example that we can solve or make progress, there is some kind of data compression going on, right? So you try to distill sort of important few parameters and then cook up some theory in terms of that. Now, this is not always, you know, you can actually do it only in a limited number of situations, right? And difficult examples where we don't know how to do it are, you know, some complicated strongly correlated materials and also interacting systems which are driven strongly out of equilibrium. I will focus on that second. If you put it just on a computer in a brute force way, well, you can do it, but you know, this exponential growth is very limiting, so you can maybe at most hope to simulate something about 40 spins or so. And there was this idea of making a quantum simulator, right, which is becoming reality. So now there are very different platforms, synthetic platforms, right, which share remarkable control, coherence, and unanimity. And so, in the first example is ultra-cold atoms, which we will cover by Manu's lectures. There are also trapped ions, spherulatic qubits, which are much smaller and can do different things. And also another very interesting system is nitrogen-based expansion diamonds. And what is nice about the systems is that the time scales are very long compared to real materials. Right, so it goes, you know, it's for the same reason that the model describes it. They're just much more dilute, these systems. And therefore, you can see what they're doing in real time, right? And you can probe some, you can get some unique insights into non-equilibrium physics. And so, and now, let's ask a very general and very naive, in a sense, question, right? So, if I have an interacting system of spins, for example, and I prepare it in a simple initial state, like a product state, so I'm just, each spin is pointing, you know, up or down or somewhere on the block sphere, and then I let them interact and I let them evolve. Right, so what happens? And you know, in thermal equilibrium, we have a lot of universality, right? And we have this notion of a phase of matter. And the key, you know, and that allows us to organize, you know, what a particular system is doing, how phase transitions between different states work, And there, really, the key concept is symmetry planning and ordering. Right?
So
understanding symmetries and how they can be broken down gives you classification of phases of matter, and you know, it doesn't matter what they're made of. If they have the same symmetry, there would be a lot of similarities. And so, can we do something similar for the non-equilibrium systems? Right. So, are there broad classes of systems which would have, you know, would have similar dynamics within a class and then very different between the classes? Right. So, would there be phase transitions? And that's, you know, those are the questions that we are, I think, starting to touch. And you'll see that it is very far from similar beautiful and ordered understanding we have in terms of equilibrium, right? But there have been interesting findings both creatively and experimentally. And you know, first thing, you know, when you ask about this dynamics, you know, intuitively you would wonder, well, wouldn't it just thermalize, right? So wouldn't you just end up in a state, right, which is effectively thermal and which you can describe by statistical mechanics. And that's what Norm was describing yesterday. So, and indeed this is of course by far the most generic possibility, right, and that's why we rarely question statistical mechanics, right, so you just read through these first couple of paragraphs in the .NET textbook, right, and then you just believe it's true. Right, but actually, so let's go back there, right, and let's recall. So what did we need for statistical mechanics description to be valid? And then we'll actually find some examples where it breaks down and then interesting things can happen. And so if you go back to those, you know, first two paragraphs, so you would recall that the StatNet is based on the concept of ergodicity, at least classically, right? And it's a statement that your system, as it goes along, right, as it evolves, it can explore essentially all the microstates which are allowed by the energy conservation, right? So there are no corners of the phase space which are blocked somehow, right? So you as you evolve, you probe all the microstates. And from there, you can derive a canonical distribution, right, and define entropy, temperature, and derive thermodynamics. Now, what is also important to realize is that thermal equilibrium states are defined by just a few global parameters. Right? That's again what Tom explained yesterday. So you just have temperature, you know, chemical potential, or particle number. And you know, just a couple of those globally conserved quantities, and so and otherwise those states are quite featureless, right? So there, you know, if you, no matter where you start, so you can start, you know, in some very nice, you know, quantum state with information that you put in locally, or even created some local entanglement, but then once it thermalizes, it's all gone, right? And your system forgets initial conditions. And now, so let me just show you a little bit, just a couple of cartoons. They are not, you know, by no means they, you know, you shouldn't view them as sort of true examples that illustrating concept of ergodicity and so on. But I think they are useful cartoons to have in mind. So here you have a stadium billiard, and then you launch a particle, and then as it goes along, so it will cover the whole, you know, its tiny phase space, and its motion is chaotic. Right, but now also, you can also ask, so what are the ingredients needed to break ergodicity in this simple, you know, simple billiards. And one example is if you have a classical system which is integrable. So here know, if I take a PR like that, it will have an extra conservation law. Because the angular momentum will be conserved, and that makes the motion regular and not chaotic. Right? And this, in this case, you would not forget about your initial condition. And, you know, of course, in mechanics, you solve a lot of examples of classical invariable system, you know, you go to the section angle variables, and so on, but conceptually important question is how stable is it? Right? So if you question is how stable is it? So if I take an invariable system and I perturb it a little bit, right, by non-invariable perturbation. So here, for example, I would say, well, let me squish it a little bit such that it's not perfectly rotationally symmetric, right? So then I can ask, so how long would the regular motion survive? And there is a theory, right, which gives you an answer, which is the Motor theory. And what it tells you that this regular motion it survives if perturbation is quite weak and, you know, it works for a few body systems under some additional conditions, which we can discuss later. Right? But the important thing is that, you know, it tells you that the gravity in classical systems is not that stable. So it's a little bit stable, right? But not, you know, if you have a lot of particles and even a weak perturbation would destroy the gravity. So, and that's why you know, maybe that's why there never really questions this theory of chaos. And, you know, entertaining example, so where, you know, a situation in which you would naturally wonder about such question of stability of integrability is the solar system, right? Because you always solve, you know, you always solve the two-body problem, which is integrable, but in fact, solar system is more than two bodies, and you can wonder, so what are the stability, you know, in which region of phase space or can be chaotic, and then one of the planets fly off. That's just an example. So now let's go to the quantum systems, right? And turns out that defining this concept of ergodicity in the quantum case is not so simple, right? And this is because essentially you don't really have the notion of microstates, right, with a well-defined energy. And you know, also defining quantum chaos turns out to be complicated because classically, you know, to define chaos, so what you do, you start into trajectories which are initially very close by, and then you see that they diverge exponentially as you go along. Right? In the quantum case, this is impossible because quantum mechanics is limited. Right? So if you initialize your system into states which are close by, right? They will stay exactly the same distance provided you evolve them with the same Hamiltonian. Right? So you can do some other things to try to define quantum chaos, right? But it's not immediately connected to the classical case. And so how do people understand thermalization in quantum systems? So there is this concept of eigenstate thermalization hypothesis, which Norm also described, right, which tells you that systems, quantum systems which thermalize, actually even their individual eigenstates have thermal observables. Right? And let me just repeat what Norm said yesterday. So if I have, let's say, a system of spins, right? And they're interacting, and I know that it's a thermalizing system, then I can consider some eigenstate M and consider some subsystem A, right? And the statement is that if I look at the state of the subsystem A, which is obtained, you know, by taking the reduced density matrix, right? So you take the eigenstate N and you trace out everything that's outside, and then you end up with a reduced density matrix of just system A, it would be very close to the thermal density matrix. With the temperature that you can compute from the energy of the eigenstate. to manage. That's what I can say. Yeah?
How do you define quantum electricity? Like, is it like uniform sampling of all the groups?
So, let me not define it. So, for practical purposes, so let's say that it's the same as terminization.
What I understood from long talk yesterday, I wonder how you like sound in inverse space, like at the end, you will have a reduced density matrix that you experiment with. Right? So it's like independent of the nature. Is it not true?
Independent of the energy. Right? Mm-hmm. The you get different eigenstates, right? You can say, and each eigenstate is defined by thermal density here, so the temperature is set by the other density.
Any more questions? And this has an interesting consequence for the entanglement. And let me ask you, so how many of you know how to define entanglement entropy? Not so many. Okay, so then I will just tell you. So you know, essentially if you take a pure state, right, pure state of the system, and in this case, right, and then so I can obtain reduced density matrix of the subsystem A, right, which is just trace over complement of A, which I'm going to call P, of the state N of N, right, and then
we use a different marker.
A different marker, okay. Is it?
So one can actually delete the permanent stuff with water. So if you just want to throw ones,
use the black ones on the right end.
So I threw some on the floor. These are the black ones. We cannot delete them anymore. So very happy to use water.
Yeah, it's still not great. Okay.
Yeah, it's not
good.
Okay. And then essentially, you know, I started out in a pure state, but then. If I have a entanglement, then the subsystem A would be the next state. But you can very easily see it if you, for example, consider two spins which are in a single state, right? And trace out one of the spins, you will see that the first spin is in the next state. And then entanglement then would be of A with respect to the state M, right? This is just defined the same as the usual polynomial. So it's rho over rho. Right. So, and in a sense, you see that if I have a product state, right, such that system A does not really care about other degrees of freedom and therefore I have no entanglement, then this quantity would be zero. Right, because still my system A would be in a pure state. Right, so that's essentially the you know way to quantify how non-classical your state is. And if I take a system which satisfies ETH, then its eigenstates would have what is known as the volume law entanglement. So if I take the entanglement entropy of this reduced density matrix, it would be the same here as thermal entanglement, right, just it will be the same as thermodynamic entropy. And we know that thermodynamic entropy scales proportional to the system size. So it will go as a volume of A. So that's the very you know very quick summary, you know, partially repeating what Tom said. And the intuition is really that thermalizing quantum systems, they're able of acting as a heat bath for their subsystems. There is a lot more. There is a lot more to this. But let's actually skip through and let's go to the systems which do not thermalize.
Can you please give some intuition about where the volume law comes from?
Where the volume law comes from? Yeah, so I think maybe it would help. So let me consider a system, right, which is thermalizing, which has you know, subsystem A and B. And let me ask what the state N actually looks like, right? So N is the state of the whole system. Right, so let me, for example, ask how I would decompose it in terms of the eigenstates of the left system and the right system. Right, so I can very generally write that N is some coefficient A N alpha beta alpha A beta B. Right, and here is where we can come back to this notion of ergodicity, right? If your system is thermalizing and ergodic, what would happen? This state N would actually made off all the, essentially all the possible states on the left and on the right allowed by the energy conservation condition, right? So even a single eigenstate, so it probes, if you wish, in some sense, all the states of the left and right system. Right? So you could very roughly say, well, if N has some energy E, you know, I am allowed to sample all the states such that their energies, you know, nearly add up to this energy E. Right? And clearly there will be clearly number of states that I am allowed to take, right? It will correspond to the volume of entropy, because it is like thermodynamics again, right? So, yeah.
Is your sampling of the state means it's coming from the supertradition itself?
It's coming from the supertradition.
Yes.
Well,
supertradition of multiple states.
It is all. Yeah, yeah. It is a very complicated big superposition for the thermal case,
yes.
Right? Now you can ask. So, actually, how do I convince myself that it should be true? And for that, okay, so for that, you know, if you guys are interested, we can spend some time on it, right, maybe in the next lecture. Because, you know, if you feel that this whole thing is very intuitive, it's kind of obvious, we just, you know, we won't do it. But if you find it kind of confusing, maybe it's helpful to spend 10 minutes, and then we can really, really kind of try to see why this is the case. So which one is it? So is it who thinks that H is confusing? Hey, nobody is.
Who thinks ETH is not confusing?
See? So guys, would you like to see it? Yeah.
I would be more interested in the non-equilibrium.
This can be pretty non-equilibrium also. So, but again, but yeah, let me repeat what I'm saying. So don't be, you know, there is no such a thing as a stupid question. So, and this, you know, this whole DH business, it took some decades to be sorted out. So, but you see that if a system thermalizes, you know, we've been talking about the eigenstates. Now, of course, we're also, you know, very interested in the dynamics. And what we haven't told you yet is how to link this ETH picture with real-time dynamics, right? So, and but intuitively, what happens if you start, let's say, you start from some state, and you roll some information into it, right? So for example, you know, I put this spin up, right? And I want to monitor the spin and see how it's doing, where this information that I recorded, where it went. So what happens as I go along, I am thermalizing, right? And thermalization also means that there is a phenomenon being generated. Right? And then as a result, this information is still there in the system, right? Because my evolution is unitary, I'm not losing anything, but it's becoming spread over the whole system, over this exponentially large Hilbert space, and then it becomes completely unrecoverable. Right? So if you want to have some long-lived quantum states in this setting, right, it's simply a natural thing to try is to find systems which do not thermalize. And so and there is one very classical quantum problem, right, where things indeed do machine learning natural place to start, which is Anderson localization. So Anderson localization also how many of you guys have seen it? Anderson localization. Okay, so a good amount. So the essence of Anderson localization is that if you have disorder in your crystal, that drastically changes the nature of the eigenstates. So you know, if I have a perfect lattice and I have a particle hopping around, my eigenstates are extended block waves, right? So we can take it from one end of the sample to the other. But remarkable fact is that if I make this lattice disordered, so let's say I can do it in various ways by, for example, changing the density of the wells, right? So what can happen is essentially localization, so your particles can get stuck on certain, you know, in certain region of space, right? And then the wave function will decay exponentially away from it. And in such a system, so clearly if it's not interacting, there can be no diffusion and no transport, right? So your system disordered makes your system what is called Anderson insulated. And for us, this is a good, you know, this is a good thing, because clearly if particles are stuck, right, they will have a hard time thermalizing once we thermal interactions. So the basic, you know, the basic question that many famous people thought about over the years is, well, now if I take this situation and I put many particles and I make them interacting, right, so what can happen? Interactions can give rise to many, many processes, so they can, for example, keep this particle here and the particle there, or, you know, move many particles, right, so whether this would restore transport or not. And, but before we go there, so let me just give you a 1 minute intuition of how Anderson localization comes about, and what is really the essence in the limit of strong disorder. So let's consider a simple model. So it would be a tight bonding model. So my particle can hop in one dimensional lattice, and I'm just limiting myself to the lowest band, right? Because as we learned yesterday, there are many bands. So I'm just considering one state per side. And the new ingredient here that I'm adding this term, which is a random on-site energy, which I would, you know, for simplicity, I would say that all this kind of potentials are completely independent and they're drawn from some distribution with variance of order W. And strong disorder would correspond to, you know, this parameter W being greater than hopping parameter J. So then what happens if you, you know, try to hop, for example, between two nearby sites, hybridization, so J is smaller, would be typically smaller than the energy mismatch, right? And you cannot hybridize, so you cannot make a transition if you wish, right? And your eigenstates would be just, you know, would be just almost particle sitting here plus a small mixture of particle being here and vice versa. Now, this is of course just the first step, so then I should ask myself, well, but maybe, you know, if I hop n sides away, maybe I can find a process which would be resonant. And you see that what I should be comparing is the hybridization matrix element with the energy mismatch, right? So, first hybridization matrix element. Typically, to hop n sides, I have to go through n processes which are off resonant, Right. It would be a, so it would be, you know, very namely, I can write this goal as J over W to power n. Now the energy mismatch, here I can choose my closest, you know, my closest level, because I have n levels, right, and they're all living in the energy window of size W, so my closest partner would have energy mismatch W over n, right, assuming that they're just distributed randomly. And you see that actually hybridization, but experiment decays is much faster, so it decays exponentially while level spacing gains on the algebraic. Right? So it becomes less and less likely to find the resonance and run away.
It's the opposite, right? Jn should be much smaller than delta n for no resonances.
So Jn is much smaller than delta n.
So I think it's just the opposite of this.
Yes. Now, this is of course only one, you know, aspect of the story, so it turns out there is a lot more in low dimensions. There is a thing called weak localization, so it turns out that in low dimensions, even if you have very weak disorder, all the states would be localized actually. And that's much more subtle, so that arises because of quantum interference effects, and we won't go there. So just focus on strongly solid. So, and now let's turn on interactions. And I can do that with just, you know, so I start with a system which is under some localized, like that. And then what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna add some finite density of particles, and I would add interactions between them. So it would be this term, right? So which is between nearest neighbors for simplicity, and it has some energy costs if you have two particles nearby. Details of this model are not so important, well, apart from the fact that it doesn't have very high symmetry, so symmetry will actually make a difference. And then, so there is a lot, you know, there really has been a lot of work which led to eventual realization that actually localization can be stable in this kind of models. And here let me emphasize also that I'm in a sense asking a very almost very naive question, because here I'm not specifying the energy density, right? I want to be at high energy. And by doing so, you know, very, very often being very general also means you're missing a lot of interesting things, right? And it's certainly the case here as well, because by doing that we are missing a lot of interesting low energy physics, right? Because you can also ask, you know, if I can maybe have a situation where I'm at low temperature and there I'm localized, but I wouldn't be localized if I go to a high temperature. And at low temperatures, I have, of course, particles, and they can get localized, so there's a lot of stuff we're leaving out by doing what I'm doing here. So now the sort of defining feature of many-body localized systems is that they're perfect insulators at non-zero temperature. Right? So you start it out, it just does not conduct. And, you know, for us, what's interesting that this is clearly a situation where statistical mechanics does not apply. And, you know, of course, if this phase was just completely, you know, not doing anything, it was a kind of a dead, you know, completely dead, and the good particles may just sit there, that would be one thing. But there are some very interesting consequences. Actually, and even interesting dynamics in this case. And that's what I'll try to cover today, and then Norm will continue, and then we'll hopefully cover most of the interesting things that happen. Right, so clearly, you know, if I go back to this cartoon picture, since I have no transport, memory of the initial state is preserved even locally. Right, so if I even let the system evolve for a long time, it would remember actually that this spin was on average you know, was initially pointing up. Right? So it would, its value would be reduced, right? It's not perfectly conserved, but it would still be nonlinear. Right? So in that respect, it is quite different from the thermalizing systems. Now, this, I formulated this in terms of fermions so far. You can also define spin model. So for example, this one. So you can have a spin 1/2 chain, which has exchange, so sigma plus, sigma minus, right, with some parameter j. It has interaction sigma z with some parameter d. And it has a random field along the direction. And this model is in fact equivalent to the fermionic model I wrote. So you can use Jordan-Winner transformation and then show that they're exactly the same. And the phase diagram, so let me fix J and B and by disorder, right? And let me ask what is the phase diagram at high temperatures, right? And it turns out that it is, you know, rather simple looking, so if I crank up disorder, it becomes minimally localized, and then there is a critical, subcritical value of disorder W star, which is of order J or V, and then you make transition to the thermal phase.
What does high temperature mean in this case? Just like high energy density of the initial state?
Yes. Indeed, that's a good point. So one should be talking about energy density and not temperature, because we are dealing with systems which are not thermalized. It just means, essentially, it means that I can prepare my system in any initial state, right? It can have very, very high average energy density, and it will still be stuck, it will still not conduct. There will be no transport and no relaxation. So guys, any other questions so far? And the way, you know, one diagnostic, you can wonder, you know, well, if I encounter some model, so how do I tell sort of quickly and dirty kind of whether it might be manually localized or not. And there is a very useful quantity, which is the level of statistics. So essentially, if you can do, you know, you can put your system on a small system on a computer, you can find its energy levels, and you can study what is the statistics of the spacing between nearby energy levels. And so you can plot this distribution, right? And turns out that it will be quite different for the systems which are thermalizing and which are non-thermalizing. So if they're thermalizing, you will see that the probability of finding two levels really nearby would go to zero, right? And it's called Big Dyson distribution, so it comes from the random matrix theory. While if you have a system which is non-thermalizing, it will be Poisson distribution. So levels do not have any trouble being nearby, so it will look like that.
Why is it that for a small disorder is thermal, but for zero disorder it's thermal?
Because at zero disorder becomes integrable by beta ansatz, right? So this model has it is just exactly solvable in the sense that Thierry was describing yesterday.
Maybe it's not for now and it should be postponed for the lunch discussion. But one thing which always bothered me with level statistics, because people play the same game for integrable versus non-integrable, is how much the level statistics, which is usually a property of the mid spectrum, the spectrum, is really describing what happens at low energy.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. So here when you say, okay, level statistics can tell you if it's minimally localized or not, is it obvious that...
You mean, so are you asking how quickly, so how what should be my energy density for me to believe that, right?
I believe that, yeah.
I thought about it, yeah, and I don't think anybody really studied it, right? So my sort of naive expectation is that as soon as you have even a few particles, right, there would be some level of repulsion. But yeah, but it hasn't really been studied, and that's a perfectly valid question. So here, I'm talking about middle of the spectrum,
yeah.
And I'm also, you know, this picture, it is quite naive in a sense, and it's also missing a lot of interesting physics, right? Partially, you know, this is because if you have a many-body system, right, level spacing becomes tiny, and by studying this, you're studying, you know, some physics at extremely long time scales, right? So, and you're missing essentially all the things which are observable. So, and there are also some finer examples, you know, like imagine if I have some tricky conservation law, which is such that it breaks the Hilbert space into sector which is very, very big and sector which is small, I will miss that, right? I will think that it is this level of repulsion. Right, so it should be, I think, taken indeed with a grain of salt.
Because for integrable versus non-integrable, this is clearly something that happens. The low energy part of the spectrum is actually going towards an integrable field. So the level spacing is one per L and it's Poisson. But of course, the model can be non-integrable. So that's why I'm always
confused. No, that's, I think also people have been using it, right? And it's not a bad thing to do, you know. As a check, but there are all these caveats one should remember. So one should not take it as a final rule. So that's a good point. But
yeah. So maybe just following up. So is it allowed to look at these level statistics kind of resolved by energy density? So looking at energy density across the spectrum, and does one expect, or is it possible for the level statistics to change as one resolves the energy density and goes from, let's say, low energy density to higher density?
It's been so, yeah. I think, as Kiri said, that I think it's, there are models where you can observe it, right? And the same goes for this model with disorder. If you have something like, I mean, one possibility, if you have something like mobility edge, right? So you have a situation where below a certain energy density things would be localized, and above them you have enough kinetic energy to delocalize and thermalize. That's been discussed, and numerically you see that, right? Numerically. This regime, even in this model, where you will see exactly that. So, guys, any other questions? I think Norm might say some more about this. Maybe we'll do this time. So now, you know, so in the beginning, so what I told you, that there are systems which are ergodic and chaotic, classically, and the ones which are integral, right? So can we draw a parallel with that as well? And it turns out that actually it's quite simple. So many body localized systems are integrable in a sense, right? It's a very different kind of integrability from beta ansatz. And so let me try to give you. So for that, so let me start first from a Hamiltonian, which is trivial. Right? This would be like the analog of a classical integrable simple Hamiltonian. So let me take my spin model and throw out the flip-flop terms. So I'm just left with sigma z and sigma z, sigma z. And this is great, so I can solve this, right? So because sigma z operator on every side is actually conserved. So you can use with Hamiltonian, and then all the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian should be simultaneous with the eigenstates of sigma z. So I can write out the full basis, so that just product states up down, but no entanglement, very, very simple. But now, so let me add the flip-flop term, and then the intuition, so if I'm staying in the many-body localized phase, the intuition somehow is that your state of your spin, let's say here, would be mostly determined by what's going on around them, and they would not care too much about spins far away. Right, so all the correlations should be very short range, and I can expect that the eigenstates would remain close to the product states. Right, so I can take these product states and then dress them up a little bit and create a little bit of entanglement between this pair and this pair, a little bit less entanglement between this quartet of spins, and then it would just converge. This, in a sense, will view it as the many-body analog of this expansion localization you have in the single particle model. And then, so what I sort of a bit more mathematically, what I can write is that I can have a unitary which is quasi-local in the sense that it only creates a short-range entanglement which connects my eigenstates to the product state. So I can take this state and act on it with unitary U, and I'll get this slightly entangled state. And you know what this also means is that I can diagonalize my many-body localized Hamiltonian, this one, and it's going to become diagonal in this product state basis. And then so you see that it's essentially one line, you know, Hamiltonian which is diagonal in this basis would commute with every sigma z. Because this is just the product state basis. So it is also the eigenbasis for sigma z on every side. And if it's an eigenstate basis, you know, it just means that both, you know, if I write H diagonal and sigma z as matrices in this basis, they're both diagonal, so they must commute. And then it means, so, you know, if H diagonal commutes with sigma z, it means that sigma z dressed with u would commute with H. That's you can just, you know, write one line. So another thing called the separator tau z. So tau iz is sigma z dressed with u and u diagonal. And you see that tau z would commute with H, and tau z would also commute with each other. Very good question. So when you can really convince yourself this will happen, indeed, so J should be much smaller than this other. Range matters absolutely. Range is very important. So if you, for example, if you were to consider a model with longer range interactions, let's say it came as a power law, then it becomes much trickier. And there is a critical exponent of that the power law. So
can I think of this pseudo-stochastic now, this power is it like collective signal particles that like interacting?
It is, so think about it as a slightly dressed, so you know, we start from this trivial example, right? When the integral of motion was completely local,
yeah,
sigma z. Now I'm going to dress it a little bit with this unitary, right?
Yeah.
So it's going to act, you know, it's going to act on this spin where it was originally acting on a couple of neighbors, and then it's essentially it's not going to touch the spins far away.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's a
pseudo
local interactive.
Mostly, yeah. There would be some exponential tails, just like for the other stabilization, right? But this would very quickly decay, and you know, this tau operators, they have a local relation, right? So they involve just a few spins. So you can principally imagine that you could manipulate them and you would see their effect in the local zone.
In addition to J being smaller than this order, do you also need B to be smaller than?
That's a slightly tricky question. So if J is much smaller than this order, then V can be pretty much anything. But this is because you know, so you can ask, well, how do you actually show this? I wouldn't say proof, because you know, proof means different things for different people. But essentially what you would do perturbation theory in J over W. In J over this order, because I would say, well, I have this. So let me do first unitary transformation, kind of like Schiffer-Wolf, if you've seen that. I'll do a probability transformation which would affect pairs of unified spins, and I try to choose it such that I will eliminate this term. I can do that, and then, you know, but that would mean also that I've generated higher order processes, I'll do it again, and then this whole thing should converge. Right? And it's tricky because, you know, as we saw with Anderson localization, this long range processes, that was a competition of an exponential versus power law. So that's a competition which is won quite easily. So here, you know, you have a lot of many body processes. Right, so it is a trickier problem. But also let me emphasize that this fact that taus are quasi local operators, that's crucial. Right? Because this, without that, you know, this thing I can write for any Hamiltonian. It's just for a Hamiltonian which is thermalizing, this unitary would be extremely non-local. Because it must from product states create many body states which would be volume law entangled, right? So it's very complicated, and that would also mean that corresponding tau operator would be extremely non-local and not useful. Right? It's so non-local that you cannot access it by measuring things locally. That's actually an interesting point. So you I think, I don't know if Norman, if you mentioned it yesterday, it's possible I was spacing out, but so it's an interesting point. So if you have any quantum many-body system, right, you can formally define a lot of conservation laws, right? Because I can define for any eigenstate n, I can define a projector. And this is conserved. But why don't we see any effect of that? Well, because it is extremely non-local, so local observables, physical observables do not care about this weird conservation. Here is something like that. Here local observables do care. So now from here you can make some progress with understanding dynamics. And for that, just like you do in the classical integrable system, you know, if you found conservation laws, well, find, you know, go to action angle variables and solve the thing, right? So here you can do something similar. So let's just write the Hamiltonian in terms of this conservation laws. Thankfully, we have lots of that. And then it's clear, you know, I could also define operators tau y and tau z, just like I define tau y and tau x, just I define tau z. So, but the Hamiltonian can only depend on tau z, right? Because they are conserved. And then I can, the whole general thing I can write would involve, you know, single tau z terms, and then tau z terms, and then triplets of tau z, and so on. And what is also important is that these interactions, very specific interactions between tau z, they would be exponentially with the separation. Right? Because they're quasi-local operators. And because the region of the Hamiltonian was local. So a very simple picture of NBL phase now that you can have is that you have this qubits, right, which have an infinity one time, but they still have this random interactions. And therefore they can dephase, and that actually gives rise to non-trivial dynamics. Right, so T2 time, so their relaxation would not be exponential, so you cannot really define T2 time, but they would dephase in a very peculiar way, thanks to this very fast decay of interactions with distance. But overall, you know, this picture you can view as a quantum analog of KM theory, if you wish. And there are many similarities at the sort of more technical level. So here, you know, if you think about it, this problem is really crucial, such that you don't get resonances. So in the KM, it's also the case. You cannot afford to have frequencies which are really close by, because then you will start making transitions. Right? But there is one nice difference, which is NBL is really a phase of matter. So meaning that if I take number of the spins to infinity, it would still survive, provided this order is strong enough. While KM presumably is only useful in few body problems. And this happens because, you know, what helps you is that in quantum mechanics, levels are discrete, right? And that makes the transitions and transport more challenging for the system. So guys, any questions up to here? No? All good? Or do you need a couple? They all decay exponentially with the biggest oration essentially. Mm-hmm. And you will have in principle all the terms, right? You will have n body terms. So guys, any more questions? Do you need a bit of time to adjust? Continue, so that's the picture. And now this has very interesting consequences for dynamics and shows that dynamics is not trivial. One question I can pose, right, is how do quantum correlations spread? So let me do a quench experiment. So I will initialize my system in some product state. Right? This state initially is not entangled. Because if I break left subsystem is still in a pure state, and then I'm gonna ask how would kind of quantum relation develop as time goes along. Right? In other words, I don't know, I can quantify it with entanglement entropy as a function of time. So first of all, if you have a thermalizing system in one dimension, what would you expect of this quantity? Okay. No, in a thermalizing system. Right. And why? So what is the simple intuition for that?
Scales are pretty long.
Density matrix quite. Well, think about quasi particles, right? Let's say if you have fermions, right? So by creating a product state, I am somehow confining them, right, and making superpositions in the k space, and once I let them go. States with different k, right? They will have some group velocity, and I will start seeing these quasi particles flying, you know, left and right, right? And then these quasi particles, we will see that, you know, they would go in two ways, and then of course they would stay in a superposition, right? So once they cross this border, they contribute to entanglement, and, you know, provided there is some final velocity at which they propagate, there would be a front going, and then I can assume that I'm, you know, getting entanglement in the volume, right, volume which goes as vt, right? And that means, you know, entanglement would be extensive, so it would go proportional to vt. Usual thermalizing system, and actually maybe Manu will even tell you about some experiments which probe exactly that, how quantum correlations spread in a thermalizing system. But in the localized system, story will be different, right? Because we, you know, all we have is this very peculiar kind of defacing, and you can. I mean, that's a simple exercise, you know, from this Hamiltonian. If you prepare a product state, so you can find how entanglement will grow, and you will find that it grows logarithmically. So that's one phenomenon which is kind of now associated with many body localization. There are others, like you can do spin echo, and spin echo would, because normally, you know, if you have, you can restore the state of your spin or your qubit with spin echo, and here it's also the case. Right, so you can, in a sense, this quantum information here, it is much more protected and it's much easier to restore, and that's what Norm would also, you know, tell much more about. But let me, I don't know, if I have 2 minutes, so let me mention another curious consequence of this whole picture. So, because, you know, at the core of this integrability, right, and this picture of the localized phase was the fact that eigenstates were just slightly entangled. Right? And one can make it more formal, but let me not go there. And what this means, you know, what this means is that there is what is called aerial entanglement of eigenstates. So let me just show you the picture of what this means. So we'll here not look at anything else yet. So it means that if I have a state, I have only entanglement near the boundary. Right? Or, you know, if I'm in 2D, I would have some narrow region around my region A where the user freedom are entangled, and then there is no entanglement outside. And turns out, so the cool fact is that such states are very special and they're easy to describe. And that actually that's been known, I think it's been, I guess, told in this way of entanglement maybe, you know, 15-20 years ago in the context of the ground states. Right, so let's take a small step back and let's go back to where we started. Right? So we have many body Hilbert space with a huge dimension, which is 2^n. And let's consider some Hamiltonian H which is correct. Right? So you know that there is a ground state separated by an energy gap. So it should come as a surprise that we can actually sort of naively, right, it should be very surprising that we can describe any sort of quantum phases, right? Because this Hilbert space is so huge. So how can we find anything there? But there is a very important fact, which is that if your Hamiltonian is gapped, its ground state will actually live in a very small corner of this Hilbert space. And this corner, right, it is really set by the entanglement properties. Right, so turns out that states which have this aerial entanglement, right, they can be presented very efficiently. In contrast to the volume of states, right, like inside the thermal eigenstates that we saw, okay, those are hard, those are truly, you know, you need in principle a lot of amplitudes to travel that. So, and very qualitatively, you know, you can actually, again, using some very very clever tricks from quantum information, you can even prove that in one dimension, if you have a ground state of a Hamiltonian, it will have aerial entanglement. You can prove it, but it's not a subject for a lecture. It's a subject for a, you know, couple of months of study. Right? It is worth thinking. But intuitively, you know, you can see that it should be true, because if you have a gap, you have a finite correlation length associated with it. So you know that somehow the user freedom here should only care about some small subset of the user freedom within the correlation length. And what we saw, right, is that MBL eigenstates, even highly excited ones, they're kind of like ground states of Hamiltonians. And therefore they can be efficiently simulated. So now, you know, why, how come such states are simple and not very complex? Well, sort of trivial example, if you look at product states, right, so I look at product states, then I can specify the state of every spin on the block sphere to this superposition. Alpha I up plus beta I down, and it's only on the two m parameters. It's only on the algebraic number of parameters in the system size, not exponential. And then, so if you have states with low entanglement, which are not as trivial, there is a machinery of so-called matrix product states. Again, so if you find it interesting, I can, in the next lecture, I can take 5 minutes and tell you how it works with just linear algebra, using, you know, one factor of linear algebra, which is Schmidt decomposition. So again, if you're interested, so there are two things, right, that we did not, you know, that I put aside, which is first of all how to intuitively understand the TH, right, it was here. Another is this one. So why, how come that states with low entanglement can be efficiently parameterized? So yeah, think about it and decide whether you want it spelled out or you just want the reference, you know, because that's also that. For this one, I'm not sure if there is a sort of direct reference where you just might tell you what to read, but for this one there is very nice. There are actually many very nice papers. But the bottom line is that you can push through this, you know, linear algebra, and then you end up with just a polynomial number of parameters. And that's really the basis for the efficient algorithm that he was describing, with density matrix generalization, time involving block decimation, but it's somehow all about entanglement. And you know, at least at a very qualitative level, so excited and PLI states are similar to ground states, and you can guess that this, you know, this should enable new algorithms, and there are attempts, but it's not, you know, it is very far from, let's say, from the reliability of DMRG. It's still, I think, it's still being explored, and the key difficulty, you know, is that the spectrum becomes very dense, so it becomes very difficult to target a given excited state. While for ground state you have, you know, you have a gap, so you're all set, you know what you're after. Right? But if you have a lot of states nearby, it gets much harder. Still there was some very nice progress, but it's an angle area. So okay, so let me stop here and let me just finish with there are also experiments, but I hope Manu will talk about it. If not, I can cover some of it. And then let me just stop here and, you know, sort of similar to how Richard had the table of going from semiconductor to cold atoms, so here we have a table of differences between ergodic and MDL. So for eigenstates, volume law, area law, eigenstate normalization, for ergodic, yes, presumably for all eigenstates, for MDL, no. And surface quantities, very different again. And spreading of quantum information is yet another distinguishing property. And the message is that, you know, you have this class of systems which do not thermalize, and they show very different dynamical properties. And perhaps what is most interesting is that coherence is protected, and there are very interesting manifestations of that. So okay, let's stop here and let's do some questions.
Thank you.
Is MBL only, does it only happen in 1D? And does it only happen in isolated systems?
So, truly it only happens in isolated systems. 1D, I would say it's pretty established, and 2D, it's being explored, but it's clear that this physics is relevant at least for some very long times, right? And there are particular experiments done by Manuel's lab, right, which see signatures of MDL in 2D.
But wasn't there like an argument that the excited states, you know, their separation scales as exponential of the area, while the matrix elements are
So this argument essentially, so yeah, what this tells you is that you can have this, maybe this avalanche effect. So let's say you have a region where the solder happened to be weak, right, and you have a small thermalizing spot. And the whole, you know, argument is about how this thermalizing spot, whether it will thermalize spins nearby, whether they can form a bigger, more powerful blast, and then keep thermalizing.
Okay.
Right. So it is an argument. It's not a, you know, it is an interesting argument, but I think it has many potential holes.
Right.
And there's also a question about, even if it's true, there is a question of how big this inclusion should be. Right, so it could be, you know, that it's there, but it's there at the time of, you know, into the whatever 100, and then, you know, from the mathematical point of view, indeed, this is not true, right? I mean, it's not true in the sense that the details of motion would not be truly conserved forever, but they would be conserved for all practical purposes.
It would be a thermal state, kind of.
Kind of, not quite. I think it's pre-thermalization is a bit different, but I think, so it's pretty clear that this physics, so in 1D, you know, if you have a truly isolated system, it's there, right? Now, you also mentioned bath, right? Mm-hmm. System not being isolated, of course, bath would also give, it would also lead to relaxation, right, and eventually thermalization, but you typically have some window, right, long window, and I mean, that's also a very interesting problem. How, if you have a bath and, let's say, localized system, right, what do they do? And there have been some nice works on that, an experiment again from Munich, and theory from, in particular, from the Hudalton group.
So it doesn't straightforwardly destroy the effect?
It destroys it, but in an interesting way and in a slow way. So, but what they do, they essentially they take this tau Hamiltonian and then they couple some, they add some dissipation to it.
Okay. I think we need more discussions about this. One question.
Okay, so I wonder how the transition from like non-interacting system to ambient happens. So if I have like non-interacting system and slightly ramp my disorder and look at the entanglement and grow, like, in the first place, like linear, then at the end it will develop like logarithmic. But what happens in between is the sharp transition, or is there like critical phase?
So do you want transition as a function of interaction or
disorder?
Disorder. So going from thermal to polarized.
Right.
That's a good question. So that's a difficult question. So it's being investigated. So, but I think it's believed that if you look at entanglement growth,
right,
at the transition point, it would be actually logarithmic, and then there would be Griffith regime where entanglement would grow as some slow power, would grow as t to some small power.
I got logarithmic normally.
Yeah, so it will go, but you can see that logarithm would be connected to this power law, and then the exponent would slowly increase once until you go with the...
So it's kind of like a crossover.
From that point of view, yes. But from other points of view,